River Publishing presents The Killing of Uncle Sam by Rodney Howard-Browne and Paul L. Williams. Read by Ian Patterson. For the River School of Government, our hope for the future. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth, and the Lord said to me, Behold, I have put my words in your mouth. See, I have this day set you over the nations and over the kingdoms, to root out and to pull down, to destroy and to throw down, to build and to plant. Jeremiah, chapter 1, verses 9 and 10. A message to the reader. Many years ago, I began asking questions about how things work in the world, governments, banking, etc. The answers to my questions were not what I wanted to hear. I realized that people in leadership and those who guide them from behind the scenes were not altruistic as we would hope they would be, but rather they were greedy, ambitious, and destructive. This book, The Killing of Uncle Sam, was born out of a desire to explore the journey of how we arrived at this place in history. How do we change it? Where do we go from here? To understand history, you must understand people's motivation, not just their actions. After years of traveling the world, trying to help people, I had a hard time grasping how hard-hearted people in positions of power could be. I didn't understand how people could sell out their nations and people just for money. Truly, the love of money is the root of all evil. Pride, greed, and power drive men to do the unthinkable. We have politicians who promise one thing and do another. It seems that many have sold their soul to the highest bidder. How does a legalized system of the private central banks go unchecked? The Ponzi scheme of Bernie Madoff was called the crime of the century, but it was not. The crime of all crimes is the legalized central banking system of the globe, where, with the help of politicians, the banks fabricate money out of nothing and pillage billions of people. The only consolation is that there is coming a day when everyone will give an account of their lives as they stand before Almighty God on Judgment Day, with no lawyer, no lies, no facade, just them and the true record of their life. I come from South Africa, and I always knew something was wrong. I just could not put my finger on it. I found out that the modus operandi of the cabal is to pit people against each other and then, while they are fighting, dispossess them of their wealth. There are wars and genocide as men fight over the mineral wealth of nations, oil, gold, diamonds, and the list goes on. You will find this book well documented with over 1,000 footnotes. I believe this book will tell the tale of the past 200 years with the common thread throughout being greed and covetousness, the love of money. In this book, you will find quotes from former presidents, prime ministers, mayors, and other leaders trying to warn the people, even though, for the most part, the warnings were overlooked by the masses. You can't see something if you don't know what you are looking for. From Cecil John Rhodes to the present day, nothing much has changed. Many who endeavor to expose the problem and to do something about it are silenced. However, it is time for people to stand up and say enough is enough and draw a line in the sand. As far as we are concerned, we will not tolerate these things while it is our watch. We will stand, expose, speak out, and move to bring about a reformation. We feel so strongly about this that if it means death, then so be it. Our founding fathers, the 56 signers of the Declaration of Independence, were prepared to lose everything for their nation and their freedom, and many did. Out of respect for them, in our generation, we will stand up. It's time. Dr. Rodney M. Howard-Browne, Tampa, Florida, USA. Prologue. Killing Uncle Sam. To destroy a people, you must first sever their roots. Alexander Solzhenitsyn. The title seems absurd. How is it possible to kill a nation? America is not a flesh and blood entity, but rather an ideology, a shared belief in the principles set forth in such documents as the Bill of Rights and the Constitution. This concept of America dates back to 1910, when British author G.K. Chesterton wrote, "America is the only nation in the world that is founded on a creed, one set forth with theological lucidity in the Declaration of Independence." This concept, known as creedalism, has been advanced by sociologists, historians, and political theorists, such as Gunnar Myrdal, Alan Bloom, and Arthur M. Schlesinger, Jr. Bill Bennett said, "The American national identity is based on a creed, on a set of principles and ideas." Senator John McCain has sanctioned creedalism by saying, "We have a nation of many races, many religious faiths, many points of origin, but our shared faith is the belief in liberty, and we believe this will prove stronger, more enduring, and better than any nation ordered to exalt the few at the expense of the many, or made from a common race or culture, or to preserve traditions that have no greater attribute than longevity." Modern U.S. presidents have endorsed this view of America. In his first inaugural address, George W. Bush proclaimed, "America has never been united by blood or birth or soil. We are bound by ideals that move us beyond our backgrounds, lift us above our interests, and teach us what it means to be citizens." Similarly, Barack Obama, at a press conference in Turkey, said, "One of the great strengths of the United States is that we have a very large Christian population, but we do not consider ourselves a Christian nation or a Jewish nation or a Muslim nation. We consider ourselves a nation of citizens who are bound together by ideals and a set of values." Creedalism has been ingrained in the contemporary American psyche. It has been proclaimed by Democrats and Republicans. It has been taught in schools and upheld in courts of law. It remains a truism virtually beyond dispute in the public forum and serves as the basis of political correctness. Who can argue that America is not unique? That aside from the remnants of the Indian tribes, the United States has no autochthonous population? That all of the 308.7 million people who inhabit our nation are either themselves immigrants or descendants of more or less recent immigrants? America remains linguistically and ethnically the most diverse country on earth. And since Americans are from different countries, they must be united by something. And that something has to be their basic beliefs as expressed by the founding fathers and upheld by U.S. jurisprudence. What else can it be? The belief that the American people are united by scraps of paper may be a comforting conceit for modern multiculturalists, but it has no basis in reality. Sure, the United States is the land of immigrants, but all nationalities, races, and religions have not been blended into a mythical melting pot and recast into something that is genuinely American. Americans throughout history have not been a vague commodity, an unidentifiable mass, or a nebulous conglomerate. Until the turn of the 21st century, they were a clearly discernible people, recognizable when traveling abroad by their speech, mannerisms, and appearance, not by their shared belief in a free marketplace or a federal union of independent states. Americans could be characterized as cartoon figures in German newspapers and lampooned.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.